So we were on mantra 13, right? Last time.
Yes.
We did a pretty elaborate discussion on mantra 13. Anyone remembers any points from mantra 13?
Demigod worshippers and where they will go and all, where we saw in the previous verses. This verse talks about the actual transcendence details of demigod worship is a slow process and actually it will not give the pure of, love of God. Eh? So it's just talking about those form features of the Lord. And it was refuting two things, Yathomat Tathomat and Manava Seva Madhava Seva. These were the two things that were.
Okay. Nothing else?
Demigod worship is a mode of goodness, but while we are doing demigod worship, we are actually attached to happiness, and that's where the problem is.
So, 13th verse talk, the essence of verse number 12 and 13 focuses on asambhavat and sambhavat. You remember, we talked about that. What is the difference?
Independent.
Someone who is independent vis-a-vis someone who is dependent on someone else for their dependence, for their maintenance, sorry. That is called as
asambhavat.
So, we have been advised not to worship the asambhavat. So, in one sense, verse 12 and 13 is talking about those entities who we should not be focusing our time in worshipping. As a part of that, the first entity was discussed was demigods. But we are not encouraged to worship demigods. Though there is nothing wrong in worshipping demigods in one sense, as in the mode of goodness. But here, we are not talking about a mode of goodness. We are talking about putting an end to the cycle of birth, disease, old age and death. So therefore, going to demigods for material benedictions, though it's not shastrically incorrect to do that, okay? So, but that doesn't come under the realms of bhakti. However, we also saw the positive side. So if someone genuinely has an affinity towards a particular demigod, not motivated by material motives, someone genuinely, purely, you know, has a lot of affection for, let's say, Lord Ganesh. So, out of love, they are serving Lord Ganesh. Not just breaking a coconut and then, you know, saying Ganpati Bappa Moriya and then asking him for so many material benefits in return. Not that kind of worship. Someone who is genuinely having, you know, an affection for Lord Ganesh and who is relentlessly serving Lord Ganesh. And if the demigod is so pleased, then the demigod directs that worship to Krishna. So in that sense, by worshipping the demigods, one can come to the platform of Krishna Bhakti. But that is a long process. So we are advised in Kali Yuga, because the lifetime is very short. So therefore, we are advised to directly worship the Supreme Personality of God. So in that sense, demigod worship is not recommended. As regards the material benediction of the demigods, whatever benedictions the demigods give, those benedictions are temporary. And sometimes they may not even be for our good. Right? Like, for example, who is that? Prakasu.
Prakasu,
Basmasu, same thing.
Same
personality.
That is carnal even, that is here too.
So, therefore, the benediction, you touch your own head and then he touched his own head and finally he was finished. So, the benediction was of no use. Hiranyakashipu, the benediction he got from Brahma, did not give him eternity. In fact, even it is said that even normal people lived more than Hiranyakashipu, despite his benediction. Normal people had a longer lifespan than Hiranyakashipu had. who never went and waited. So it was like that. So therefore, we don't worship, we don't approach the demigods for material benefits. That is not considered as bhakti. So that is asambhava. Then we talked about the second type of people who we don't worship. Who are those? Human beings. Manav seva, madhav seva. So that is not scripture. Nowhere in the scriptures it says madhav seva, manav seva, madhav seva. But it doesn't mean we don't worship, we don't serve humanity. It's not that devotees don't serve humanity. But devotees know the right way of serving humanity. For example, if a person is hungry, then we don't only feed his belly, but we also try to solve his problem of hunger forever. Right? There are various levels at which hunger can be addressed. At a very operational level, at an operational level, how can hunger be addressed? By giving food or money. No. By giving food. You don't have to give prasadam only. Even without prasadam also, hunger is satisfied anyway. So at a very operational level, you give food to the person. Suppose a beggar is coming, he doesn't have a job, he is begging. So you give him food, so his hunger is gone. Second level, at a tactical level, what you could do? You can give him an employment, you can train him. So that then, what do you say that? If you feed one fellow for a day, then you feed him for a day. But if you give him, teach him something, you feed him for a lifetime. So that is again a tactical solution. But a strategic solution, the best solution to this problem is, you give him Krishna consciousness, right? You give him Krishna consciousness, by which what will happen is, he will not have to take birth in this material world after he leaves this body. Okay, because hunger is a phenomenon associated with the material body, right? That is one. And even in this lifetime, by doing bhakti, then he can burn his prarabdha and aprarabdha karma, by which he may not have to undergo that hunger at all, because bhakti is klesha agni, it burns material business. So even from that point of view, you give him bhakti. However, we have to be sensitive. Okay, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu also says that we have to be sensitive. It doesn't mean if a beggar is coming, you know, he doesn't have any hands and legs. Okay, and then he asks you, please give me food. Then you give him a beadbag saying that chant the holy name. That simply means that we are being very insensitive to that person. So, devotee doesn't mean not helping someone materially. Okay? Devotee means helping someone materially to solve their immediate problem, but going beyond that and giving them a permanent solution. Right? So, even in ISKCON, for example, we heard that, you know, the Food for Life of ISKCON has won an award, right? So many awards. Our Food for Life program is very highly recognized by the government. Okay. So in ISKCON, we also do food distribution. But we don't only feed the people and just stop. We also give them philosophy, Krishna Bhakti. So that we not only feed the body, but we also give nourishment to the soul. Because it is the soul which is ephemeral, whereas the body is temporary. So these are different viewpoints. So, manav seva, madhav seva. So, the best service to a child is to unite the child with its parent. Srila Prabhupada often gives this example. That if the son of a wealthy person, okay, if the son of a very wealthy person has got separated from the parent, then, and he is hungry, then you can give that person 10 rupees and he can buy one lollipop or ice cream and eat. However, if you reunite with his father who is very wealthy, then the person never is hungry again.
Correct.
For the rest of his life. Okay. So similarly, we are in the process of reuniting the children of God with the Bhagavan who is very opulent. Then another aspect we saw is yato mat tato pat. Yato mat tato pat means any process that you follow, whatever process you adopt, that is your whatever opinion you have, mat, whatever is your mat, whatever opinion you have, so is your path. So that then, so Chaitanya Charan Prabhu mentions, so that means there are as many religions as there are many human beings. Everyone invents his own religion. Yato mat tato path. So we saw the futility of that also, because all paths do not lead to the same goal. We saw several shastrical points which refute the fact that all paths lead to the
same goal.
Same goal. We saw in Bhagavad Gita where Lord Krishna says, if you do this, you will attain this destination. If you do that, you will attain that destination. Right? So he never said, you do whatever, you will attain the same destination. He has never said anything like that. Right? So these are the things which we saw. Also, finally, the ultimate concept is, everybody is God. So worship yourself. Okay, take care of yourself. That's all. You will go back. Just don't trouble anyone else. Take care of yourself. And then you will attain moksha. So that is also bogus. Because bhakti means service. Service to somebody else, not service to our own selves. Some more points which we could not discuss in the last class.
We also saw philanthropy.
We also saw philanthropy. Yeah. Our philanthropy is good, but if you give a person, if you give some, mostly in India, if beggars come, not all, but many of them, if you give them prasadam, they say, paisa ne, paisa dena. Why? Because they want to go and play satta after that on the road. They'll put all the coins and they'll play cards or something. They'll bet that and they'll lose that also, right? So there is no point in wasting valuable money by giving this to them. They don't know how to use it, right? Chaitanya Charan Prabhu was mentioning one incident that when he was in college, he said that he was in the spiritual leadership team in his college. Okay. Obviously, we know when he's a team, then he must have been a spiritual leader, but he's not saying that. He said, I was in the spiritual leadership team or something. But then he says, one of his friends, he was very much into this village welfare. So he was more into that kind of leadership, social activities, social philanthropy and all that. So he said that his friend used to go village to village and give the children material education. A for apple, B for biscuit, C for chocolate, D for donkey, So bachcho sab log, you hear, no? Even in Hindi movies sometimes, the hero is a very simple man and then he is going to the village and teaching A, B, C, D to the students, no? Like that. So they are called as a nice man, good people. So he is a good man, going there and teaching all these things. And then he educated the villagers also. And then after that, then the spiritual leadership team went. So they were very receptive. It's a nice talmel. Nice talmel. Talmel means what? Coordination. Spiritual leadership went and they started also following some chanting. They are told, no, you should not take alcohol, no meat eating. Haan sahab. Everything was fine. So just after a few days, election time came. So he said one politician came there to the village in a big truck. And in the entire truck, he had alcohol bottle free. He said, whoever votes, some nice, very high quality liquor. Liquor anyway is third class quality. In that, whatever was high quality. So high quality liquor he brought. And he said that he started giving it to everyone so that they are encouraged to vote for him. So, and they didn't know. But completely, when they saw it, all these four regulative principles went flying out of the window. Because now they are presented with the objects of their senses. So everyone took that. Not only that, he said, because he gave everything free, the father also encouraged the son, to be bilayi. Pata nahi kab zindagi mein milega aisa wala. So he said, do be bina. So even the children were drinking. So he said that they were in a worse of condition. So you can imagine, if you give this kind of father money because he is poor, he will spoil himself, he will spoil his children also. So, and then he found that all this material education of A is equal to apple, B is equal to biscuit, or knowledge of how to write English, how to do mathematics, this will not build character in people. So we have to build character in society. Material education does not necessarily build character in society. So he said that this is a learning which he got. Therefore he decided, I want to dedicate myself to something which will help build character in society. And that was Prabhupada's mission also. One of the missions of ISKCON is what? To build first class brahmanas and position them as the head of society. Because if the strategic layer is not addressed, then no other layers will be addressed. Because all the policies, systems, procedures, everything will be third class. If there are no shared values in society, everything else is collapsing. Right? If the shared value itself is life is short, enjoy, then the structure, systems, processes, policies, everything will be governed towards that only. So he says that. So he says that if people say, why you people are not, worshipping the deities, rather you can use the money which you are worshipping the deities to feed the poor people. So Chaitanya Prabhu says that is just emotional manipulation of devotees. That's all. They are just trying to manipulate us by such statements. Right? And trying to feel very good by not coming to the temple. Everyone wants to live with his own conscience. Right? So, people who are not educated in the scriptures, they will give their own ideas. They will just continue smoking and doing sense gratification, but they will give big philosophy. So we also said last time, why don't you see God in beggars? How will you refute that point? Remember? Huh? Why don't you see God in beggars, if they tell? What will be your response? Why beggars? See God in animals also.
Everywhere.
And then they'll go away silently. Because obviously, no. They'll be eating meat. So not only beggars, even in animals we can see God actually. So then Chaitanya Prabhu goes on to talk about, if people simply become vegetarians, then greater than 50% of the land which is today used to give fodder to animals can be used to give food to human beings. So what they are doing now is they are feeding the animals with fodder so that the animals become fat, so that more flesh will come. But it is said that the amount of food, when you start giving animals, animals can go on eating, right? But the proportion of flesh they produce, if you take ratio, if a man eats this much, he can produce so much. But if an animal eats so much, the marginal utility principle of economics, then the flesh is not directly proportional to that all the time. You know what I mean? So more and more you feed, itna hi flesh niklega jada usse. If that food you give to human beings, then it said that poverty, hunger can be eradicated from this world. But you are feeding the animal so that you can get little bit more of flesh from that. So that is another point. Then he mentions about alcohol. If you eradicate intoxication from this world, if you stop all these beer bars and whatever, pubs, okay, then so many poor people can be fed. Okay, because he says that to produce alcohol, beer specifically, you need sugarcane. Okay, I don't know the relationship, but it's got some molasses, something is there. Okay, don't ask me. But they produce a lot of sugarcane simply to feed it to the alcohol industry. Okay, so rather than sugarcane, then you can produce some other crops. So lot of arable land is used to produce cash crops rather than whatever is required to give basic food to mankind. So there are very nice statistics that here given here in this regard. So manav seva, madhav seva, how to do? Only a person who is well versed with the scriptures will be able to implement such effective policies to eradicate starvation, hunger, everything from society. So he says that by taking Krishna consciousness, it makes people selfless and reduces greed in man. The reason for starvation is not scarcity. The reason for starvation is greed. Okay, it's not scarcity. God has given enough in earth. It is because of greed that some people don't have. So again, he has given a statistic. I can't remember it. But it is said that, I don't know, it's like a Pareto diagram. 90% of the wealth of this world is concentrated in the hands of 10% of the people. It's something like that. So it's that bad, right? Majority of wealth of the world is concentrated in with a few minority of people. So the wealth distribution is completely, it's not equitable at all. So he's talking about that. So he says, Krishna consciousness, if you give to these wealthy people, therefore, then it will make them selfless. When that wealth is then released for welfare activities, then you can imagine the sky is the limit. There will be no poverty at all. But we have to change the consciousness of, not all wealthy people are bad, I'm not saying that, but people who are, who have accumulated and who are hoarding this wealth only for their, themselves and their families and still greedy to accumulate more. We are talking about those people. So if those people, if somehow they come in contact with a pure devotee, their consciousness can be changed, they can be encouraged and motivated to surrender to Krishna and to help the mission of spreading God consciousness in the world, then all that, all their wealth becomes available to society to effect a very, to initiate a very effective movement without financial stress. So he talks about that. He gave another very good example that Mother Teresa, when she was asked, what is the secret of your compassion? Mother Teresa was asked, what is the secret of your compassion? So she said, pointing to the rosary, she was chanting on a rosary, so she said, by praying to God, I feel love for God. By praying to Him, I feel love for God. And in that love, I feel love for all His children. So I want to help them. So when you are surrendered to Krishna, when you start loving, then you will also start loving His children automatically. Right? Just like a neophyte, initially starts with love of Krishna. Right? I'm not saying pure love, but at least whatever it is, he comes to only to see Krishna in the temple, correct? A new devotee will not associate with, talk to anyone else. He'll just come, take darshan and go away, right? But that love will then, the Lord will then change the consciousness of that person to start loving devotees as well. So Mother Teresa was mentioning this point. Lord Krishna, again, he quoted Bhagavad Gita 6.32. He is a perfect yogi who by comparison to his own self sees the true equality of all beings in both their happiness and their distress. O Arjuna, spiritual advancement builds compassion. Spiritual advancement does what? It builds compassion. He said a nice statement. If you want, you can note it down. Spiritual compassion means feeling like how Lord Krishna feels. That is called as compassion. Compassion is what Lord Krishna feels for His children. So when that compassion comes in us, that means we feel for His children like He feels for His children. I thought it was a nice way of putting it. It may sound too simplistic, but I found something deep in that.
Say it again.
Pardon?
Can
feeling like Lord Krishna feels. That is called as compassion. Then he went on to talk about many poor people, they have their own inadequacies, which we already talked about. Alcohol addiction. People are not necessarily poor for no fault of theirs. Many people are not poor for no fault of theirs. Some people are, they ruin their own lives by either taking that, what is that, pan parag, tobacco, you know, and then getting cancer, you know, whatever. Then they are a burden on society. Right? If you get any disease because of the natural karma, then fine. That's a different issue. But people are killing themselves with all these substances and becoming a drain on the government. Even in this country it's happening. So he says that there is a preponderance of psychological needs over physical needs. Preponderance means dominance. So when your psychological needs take priority over your physical needs, then that is a problem, big problem in society. So then you are providing more for the psychological needs of people than for the physical needs of people. It's like saying, I am very hungry for gulab jamun. What do you mean by that sentence? I am very hungry for gulab jamun. So if you are hungry, you can eat dal or chapati also. You don't need gulab jamun. So therefore it is not a physical need. It becomes a psychological need that I want gulab jamun only right now. So the more and more we feed the psychological needs, more and more we are wasting the resources. So in conclusion he's saying, even the poor people have to be changed internally. It's not only the rich people who have to be changed internally. It's the poor people also who have to be changed internally. And then finally, summary statement. Both greedy and needy need to be given Krishna consciousness. Both greedy and needy both need Krishna consciousness. So these points I specifically wrote down so that it will be helpful, because many of you are doing programs, I'm sure you will get all these questions. So please make notes, otherwise take it and photocopy. Okay? Because this lecture I don't think is transcribed anywhere. So you can tell me, or I'll take it to all the cell servants. Soft copy.
Yes, please.
Because I made notes, elaborate notes of that lecture. A poor man's karma can be changed by Krishna consciousness. Mere good intentions is not enough. When it comes to Manav Seva, Madhav Seva, mere good intentions is not enough. So he told an example. I don't know whether I told it last time. Maybe I didn't tell it. During Srila Prabhupada's time, what happened was, one day Prabhupada was walking with some of his servants, disciples, and then he found that from one house, there was a mother yelling at the daughter. Probably she was beating the daughter or something like that, and yelling at her, very upset with the daughter, and daughter was crying. So Prabhupada said, what happened? Find out. So the devotees went and said that in this house, there is a mother, there is a daughter, and then there is a son also, which means brother of the daughter. Two children. So it seems that the son is afflicted with jaundice. And doctor had specifically said that because you have jaundice, you should be very regulated in your eating. No oily foods, avoid completely. So it seems that son was avoiding all oily foods, but then the mother went for some job or something like that. So the son asked the sister, can you bring some pakodas from the street? Now you know in India how pakoda is made, no? Better, no, I don't describe it. To the street one, So she went to that bhajiya fellow, outside, That fellow will use the oil for, 2 months, the same oil he will be using. So he took bhajiya and then she fed him, and that fellow became critical. He started vomiting, and already he was in jaundice. And therefore the mother was very upset with the daughter. He said, how dare? He said, but my intentions were good. Your intentions might have been good, but do you know the disease of the patient? That's the point that Chaitanya Charan Prabhu is trying to make. So he says that as devotees, we will get the wisdom to understand what is the disease of a particular patient, and therefore what is the medicine that patient should be given. Does that make sense? Yeah. So that kind of astuteness, if you like, we have to develop by studying the Shastras. Only by studying the Shastras and following devotional service will we get that wisdom, right? And also when we are doing devotional service, sometimes we are faced with very difficult situations to handle, right? So at that time, then Lord Krishna says, Dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. So if your members, for example, are coming to you with some issues and they are difficult issues, then how do you answer? The only way is by praying to the Lord. Because who is answering at the end of the day? Who are we to answer anything? Right? Who are we to address anybody's issues? Right? So we can only beg to the Lord to empower us to serve with integrity. That's all we can do. We can't do anything else, right? And even that, sometimes we may go for. Even in that, right? Because of our own follies and inefficiencies, right? So therefore, mere good intentions are not enough. We need to also know how to help someone. Social service, of course, he says, of course, because of all these points, social service should never be undermined. It should never be undermined. And it must be done. And he gave a beautiful example. This is of Prithu Maharaj. I don't know, which canto is Prithu Maharaj?
Fourth canto,
yeah. So where, what happens is, was it fourth canto or what?
Fourth canto.
Is it? Okay, fine. So, Prithu Maharaj, when he is faced with, what happens, right? When Prithu Maharaj advent, the earth is not producing enough. So what he doesn't say earth is not producing enough. No, this is all your karma only. He is not sitting. He is initiating lot of activities to make the earth produce. So it is, in one sense, lot of agrarian activities he is introducing. Leveling the earth, it is mentioned there. So it's not that Prithu Maharaj only, is sitting tight on that issue. So as a leader, we must do social activities also. We must not undermine the importance of social welfare activities. But the issue comes when we make social welfare activities more important than devotional service. That is the issue. So, a lot of nice points he made in this lecture. And finally he mentioned that Lord Chaitanya, when Lord Chaitanya was in Grihastha Ashram, even as a householder he used to do a lot of charity. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself used to go to the poor people and give. When the Lord can do it, why we cannot do it? So he led by example. In conclusion, he says, social service which is divorced or divorced, social service which is divorced from spiritual reformation is useless. Social service which is not connected to spiritual reformation is useless. What is that? Dharma sva anushtita pumsam vishvaksena kathasuya na utpade radirati ramayevi kevalam. Any activity that does not produce rati or does not take the soul closer to Krishna is useless waste of time. Even though it may apparently look like a very, very a masterpiece of social work, but it is useless if it doesn't unite people with God, or if it doesn't go to the root cause and address the root cause of that problem. Then Prabhupada says, it is only, all social welfare activities are only a patchwork, Prabhupada writes. I don't know where it is right, Bhagavatam or Pence of Self-Relation. I remember this statement, somewhere he writes. It's only a patchwork. But spiritual reformation activities, when they are connected, sorry, when social service is connected with spiritual reformation, then it is a, in Hindi we say sone pe suhaga, which means it is what? In English, can someone translate? I don't know the English translation.
Fragrance.
Pardon?
Fragrance.
Fragrance in the?
Gold.
Gold. Fragrance in the gold. It's added to the gold. Sone pe suhaga. So, for example, in ISKCON we have the food for life. Then we have a good example of Bhaktivedanta Hospital. Right? These are all examples. So, if your Bhaktivedanta members have these kind of questions, you can answer it in this way. Because this is one of the common most questions that I have faced in every single program that I have done. Whether it is an established Bhaktivriksha or whether it is a new outreach program, you are talking to people for the first time, invariably this question comes. Manav Seva?
Manav
Seva. These are all lots of, now he has harmed us, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu has given us a lot of arsenal to address this. Okay. Any questions, thoughts on this? Because we have only 4 more verses before the course gets over. At least my part gets over. Then I have to give you an exam. Close book again. After it's all up to you. Any questions, thoughts?
I have a comment, Prabhuji. In this connection, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu was pointing out Indradhumna Maharaj's visit to Sri Lanka when Sri Lanka was leader of the bank, the LTT gangs and all that. He went just with the initial intention of with Food for Life, with the support from Food for Life program. However, the government was asking more of trauma therapy than of food at that point in time. And Maharaj was so ecstatic at that point in time, and he was exactly wanting that kind of request from them. And then he started Kirtan amidst of that calamities, and he started Hare Krishna and responded. So when he inquired, it was said that they know Ram. So he started with Jai Jai Ram Sitaram, and the people, when they were crying before and after this Kirtan and during this Kirtan, people completely changed, and morally they got boost, they were boosted like anything, and they started, their smiles, he could see the smiles in their face amidst of their broken all things, their cars and house etc. They are smiling and they are enjoying, they are dancing and singing, even without their food. For the duration of 40-50 minutes. So Maharaj wrote in a diary also that it's a very great thing that he has realized a lot in that. So he was comparing humanitarian activity done by a spiritual person. So a sub-circle within an entire circle of spirituality is a human.
Okay, let's go to mantra 14. One should know perfectly the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, and his transcendental name, form, qualities and pastimes, as well as the temporary material creation with its temporary demigods, men and animals. When one knows these, he surpasses death and the ephemeral cosmic manifestation with it. And in the eternal kingdom of God, he enjoys his eternal life of bliss and knowledge.
By its so-called advancement of knowledge, human civilization has created many material things, including spaceships and atomic energy. Yet it has failed to create a situation in which people need not die, take birth again, become old, or suffer from disease. Whenever an intelligent man raises the question of these miseries before so-called scientists, the scientist very cleverly replies that material science is progressing and that ultimately it will be possible to render man deathless, ageless and diseaseless. Such answers prove that scientists' gross ignorance of material nature. In material nature, everyone is under the stringent laws of matter and must pass through 6 stages of existence: birth, growth, maintenance, production of byproducts, deterioration, and finally death. No one in contact with material nature can be beyond these 6 laws of transformation. Therefore, no one, whether demigod, man, animal, or plant, can survive forever in the material world.
Okay, what are the points?
Prabhupada says that what the material scientists are talking is like giving a post-dated check.
You never run it in real life. You can bounce also. Good example. Where did you read it?
Prabhupada. Life comes from that.
Life comes from that. Good example. Anything else?
Natural process of from birth to death, and it's happening and it will happen, and scientists are basically not just accepting it, and one need to accept this fact in order to start living in a real manner.
They're imagining so many things but they're not able to get the solution for the real problems.
The ultimate goal of this was where Prabhupada wants to establish the pastimes, Rupa Guna, the Leela, or to be understood superior. So for that to start, he is in his own thing, style, he is starting with the diffusion of matter and therefore how it can be, how to overcome, and then he will be discussing the core process.
Is that a point or not?
I think that's what the theme is. That's all the verse is.
Well, they're doing it because there's a market for it. There's a demand. And so scientists come out with that and they've got a very great faith in the scientists. Why wouldn't they do it if the people are happy to buy it? That's what they want to hear, see, believe. They want to live eternally or disease, you know. And then there's the other path available, then that's the only thing. It is natural for human beings to want that. That's the only avenue they see, the scientists. So they're treated like gods.
But it is like exploiting the ignorant person. So a person is ignorant and scientists try to misuse that ignorance and rather than even the truth. Some scientists will come and even tell you, without God, this thing can't exist. Most of them now, go there, that will help on their own needs. It's much more exploiting the ignorance. And then the question like on how much Kali has to play this role in this whole thing, because of Kali Yuga this thing has to.
Yeah. Yeah. So we cannot stop the natural wave of deterioration. What is that verse? Tatascha anudinam dharmam satyam shaucham shamadaya. Kalina balina rajan. So the tide of Kali Yuga cannot be reversed by us. Because it is the cosmic design, if you like. It can't be reversed by we human beings. But the Lord sends His devotees. It's like saying that it's like if a building is susceptible to fire, right? Which means because of some causes, because it's amidst some forest, and in Australia you know what happens, bushfires, then every house is burned. But you can still give a fire extinguisher to everyone to help themselves and make the best use and save themselves despite the fact that there is fire all around, right? So bhakti is like that. We can't change the design. Like Devamrit Maharaj says, this material body is meant to deteriorate. This world is also meant to, material world is a place meant to frustrate. So we cannot say that no, I'll change the, what is that? Some songs are also like that. You know? Some new Robin Hood will come, and then new days will come. Naya zamana aayega and all. So no naya zamana is going to come. This zamana is going to only rot further and further. So nothing, no new Satya Yuga is going to come within this Kali Yuga. It will come only after annihilation anyway. So we can't do anything about it, but we have to take a step back and understand that Kali Yuga has also been designed only for the greediest, lustiest, proudest people, if you like. Because we, all of us, had a chance in Satya Yuga, which was four times that. How many times the Satya Yuga is of Kali Yuga?
Four.
Double. 8 times? I don't know. Right? So we had a chance to deliver ourselves at that time. We didn't. We moved on to Treta, then we moved on to Dwapar, and here we are after 5000 years also we are here with our interests in, with a variety of interests other than devotional life. Correct? So this is our problem. So we have to understand that the material world has been designed because people like us are there. We want bhukti, so therefore the Lord has created this bhukti. But it is the design of the Lord also that this material world after Kali Yuga will rot and perish. So it gives a good opportunity. By its design, it is enticing us back to Godhead. And people who assist the Lord in that activity go back to Godhead. The preacher is most dear. So we have to understand it that way. Actually, Prabhu, I was answering your question. I don't know where you are. If I ask you, did I answer you, you will say yes. Probably because you are not hearing.
No, I was hearing.
Okay. So it is our interest. It is our interest to assist in the Lord's mission. That's what I was saying. We can't change Kali Yuga, but we can save people from becoming victims to the machinations or schemes of Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga has several schemes to entice. So we can insulate people from those that from they becoming enticed by these things. Does it make sense? That is what we are. That's our family business. Our family business is not to try to change Kali Yuga. Our family's business is to empower people so they can survive the onslaughts of Kali Yuga and also help others in surviving the onslaughts of Kali Yuga and going back to Godhead after this lifetime. So that is our business. Let's move, read further. Who wants to read? You want to read, Madhuri? Yeah. There are loudly one.
All the material planets.
The duration of life. Mantra 14.
The duration of life varies according to species. Lord Brahma, the chief living being within this material universe, lives for millions and millions of years, while a minute germ lives for some hours only. But no one in the material world can survive eternally. Things are born or created under certain conditions. They stay for some time, and if they continue to live, they grow, procreate, gradually dwindle, and finally vanish. According to these laws, even the Brahmas, of which there are millions of different universes, are all liable to death, either today or tomorrow. Therefore, the entire material universe is called Madhya Loka, the place of death. Material scientists and politicians are trying to make this place deathless because they have no information of the deathless spiritual nature. This is due to their ignorance of the Vedic literature, which contains full knowledge confirmed by mature transcendental experience. Unfortunately, modern man is averse to receiving knowledge from the Vedas, Puranas and other scriptures.
Okay. What are the points here?
Okay, the scientists are also looking for the same thing, but in the wrong place.
They don't know where to look for eternal life.
Morning conversation, Prabhupada says, scientists, they study things. So if they are studying, how can you call someone a scientist? They are students. They call themselves scientists. Nobody gives them the title. They call themselves research scientists. And then Prabhupada further goes to say, if they are studying, firstly, they cannot claim. And the other thing is, something else Prabhupada said, that if they don't know the conclusion, and further if they are speaking, and people are listening, they should at least have the intelligence to know that they are fools. Because people are also, you know, less intelligent. They are making business. But when an intelligent man asks, intelligent man should question. And if an intelligent man questions, they make a big deal out of it. Something like that. The essence was, they are students, they are not scientists. Because they should be able to give the conclusion, whereas they don't know the conclusion.
They are studying someone else's conclusion.
Exactly.
So even Brahma, whose life is millions of years, even that lifetime is very small in comparison to the time in terms of infinity. Even a big number divided by infinity is zero. Right? So because we think in terms of Kali Yuga time, then for us it sounds like a very big time. But from their point of view, it is very minuscule. Kadamakaran Maharaj was once mentioning that, you know, he said that when we get lot of rains, you know, recently in Chennai there was flood. We call it as lot of water and flood. We call it as devastation. But he says that if you go to your kitchen, you take sugar, and you start just throwing the sugar all around in your kitchen. How much sugar is that? Mutti bar, how much sugar is this much? Hardly few grams. You throw it. For the ant who is seeing, it is raining food from the heavens. For the ant. So that's the referential problem, reference point problem. So from our reference point, we think something is very great up there, just like the ants from their point of view. In fact, I realized this more when I saw a movie called as Ant Bully. I don't know whether you have seen this. I took Aditya when he was young for this movie. Have you seen this movie?
Ant Bully, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Yeah, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. You have seen these movies, right? So when you see it from the lens, the world from a lens of an ant, then it is saying a huge, showing a huge rat, you know, with a big mouth like that. So the ant is looking like this, you know, at it. So from a ant's point of view, everything looks very significant. But from our point of view, everything looks very... Just like when we sit on an aircraft, when we see Melbourne becoming smaller and smaller, and all the lanes and by-lanes disappear virtually, we don't even know where is Collins Street. After a few feet on top, we don't know. So because we are so much under... This is what is called as illusion. Because we are so much illusioned by our size and our thinking, then we think our problems are the biggest problem in the world. Like that we think. But actually they are insignificant. And we are also insignificant. So, and material scientists are trying to solve world's problems. The world itself is insignificant in the cosmos. So therefore by following them, even if they solve the problem, it will make not much difference to the entire cosmos in any case. It will only be pertaining to one particle of dust which is floating in the universe. Whereas, this knowledge is directly coming from the spiritual platform. This knowledge gives us experience of transcendence. Brahma Saukhyam Tvanantam. So, we do a lot of hard work to get material education, and then we use this material education to work very hard in the industry to make some money. With that money we want sense enjoyment, which we think is the goal of life. Therefore last week we saw one verse. You remember? Anyone remembers? What is that verse? We quoted Rishabhadev's verse. Nayam Devo Deya Bhajam Niloke Ashtan Kaman Arakate Vit Bhujam Deya. You don't remember this one? Tapo Devyam Putrakaya Satvam Shuddhyan Yasmat Brahma Saukhyam Tvanantam. So which means this human form of life is not meant to work like dogs and hogs for mere sense gratification. Rather it must be used for all education whatever we have, whether it is material or spiritual, spiritual anyway, but even on material education we must try to leverage that in understanding scriptures better. If by material education I have learned English as a language, then I use it to study Srila Prabhupada's books written in English. So I use the material knowledge in that sense to escape the cycle of birth, disease, old age and death and experience existential bliss or the bliss that transcendence provides. Okay? That should be the goal of life. Not simply running after the scientists trying to solve, trying to better sense gratify or trying to change the wave of the Kali Yuga. And trying to move towards eternality, because that is not possible. Yeah.
Actually, I am not that the reason why we all have this fascination towards becoming deathless is because the soul itself is eternal. So, soul doesn't have any death, so that's why we have this fascination for becoming deathless. But because the soul identifies with the body, it tries to make the body deathless, which is not possible, without realizing that he himself is. That's why.
Okay. Good point. Anything else? Okay, let's go further. Okay, then.
From the Vishnu Purana 6.7.61, we receive the following information. Lord Vishnu, the personality of Godhead, possesses different energies known as Para and Apara. The living entities belong to the superior energy. The material energy in which we are presently entangled is the inferior energy. The material creation is made possible by this energy which covers the living entities with ignorance or avidya and induces them to perform fruitful activities. Yet there is another part of the Lord's superior energy that is different from both this material inferior energy and the living entities. That superior energy constitutes the eternal, deathless abode of the Lord. This is confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita, 8.20. All the material planets, upper, lower and intermediate, including the Sun, Moon and Venus, are scattered throughout the universe. These planets exist only during the lifetime of Brahma. Some lower planets, however, are vanquished after the end of one day of Brahma and are again created during the next day of Brahma. On the upper planets, time is calculated differently. One of our years is equal to only 24 hours or one day and night on many of the upper planets. The four ages of Earth, Satya, Treta, Dwapara and Kali, last only 12,000 years according to the time scale of the upper planets. Such a length of time multiplied by 1,000 constitutes one day of Brahma, and one night of Brahma is the same. Such days and nights accumulate into months and years, and Brahma lives for 100 such years. At the end of Brahma's life, the complete universal manifestation is vanquished.
Okay, so what are the points?
Time is relative.
Time is
relative to the planet that you are.
So, who was the king who went?
Katwanga.
Maharaj Katwanga went to solve the problems and said Brahma. And then what happened? He said, I'll go back. But Brahma said, there is no point. By the time you go back to your material world, so many generations would have passed. Nobody will know who you are and which problem you are trying to solve. Right? So that is the nature, that is the time difference between the
upper
planets and the lower planets. Recently, in the 10th canto, we studied that, you know, this is the first chapter of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, which is called as the Advent of Lord Krishna, Introduction. Right? The first chapter of the 10th canto. There it is mentioned that obviously, after Sukadeva Goswami is asking, you know, Parikshit Maharaj all those questions. Why did Lord Krishna advent? All those questions he is asking Parikshit Maharaj asking Sukadeva Goswami. Sukadeva Goswami is congratulating Parikshit Maharaj once again for those questions. And then what happens? Then the story, the pastime begins. That Mother Earth took the shape of a cow and then went to Lord Brahma. And then what was Prabhupada mentioning there? Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur has written in Sararatha Darshini that Brahma which he went to was a local Brahma.
Local.
Remember I mentioned this?
Lower class.
It was not the Brahma which resided in Satyaga, because if she would have gone and come back, then the problem would have been probably irrelevant by that time. So therefore, she went to a local Brahma and then came back. So that is because of the time difference. There is one more revelation in the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto also.
Local Brahma
means there is an aspect of Brahma which is there, like for example, RMIT University ka local office hota hai. So you don't have to go till, you know, wherever. Like Kumon ka ek branch ghar ke baju mein hoga. No, seriously, like that, which is accessible to us.
So where
does
he
reside? Where does he sit? Who remembers? Shweta.
Yes.
Where is the Brahma
reside? Before the Shweta.
Or which?
Before Shweta.
If you have 10th canto, can you just see the 10th canto? Somewhere locally is there. So not very far off. I don't remember, but it is on the top of some Mount Sumeru. Yeah? Mount Sumeru.
That's what he said.
Huh?
Somewhere in one of those dvipas only Brahma reside.
Only those dvipas. Somewhere it is there. I can't remember right now.
So in this universe, there is only one Brahma, right?
There is only one Brahma, but Brahma manifests locally also somewhere. But he had enough head to advise Devaki, Mother Earth, to give a solution to her problem. So the point right now is that there is a
time
travel which will make problems also insignificant. By the time you go there and come back, many generations would have gone.
How would you feel? By the generations that have passed, how is your life calculated and how do you feel how much you have traveled? You know, it's like I'm 30 years, but if you are not feeling like millions of years living, you're still living like 100 years, so...
I have to experience it. I only got some glimpses of it in Steven Spielberg's movie Back to the Future. That's all. You seen that?
I don't watch movies.
He's a devotee.
There are two stages when you will watch movies. One is when you are young, and then when your son is young. At these two stages, you have to watch movies. Anyway, it's a good movie. You can watch it. Stevens, it's a clean movie. Doesn't have any nonsense.
Some of this time, like, it also extended the Brahma Vimogan Lila also explained.
Brahma Vimogan Lila also explained. What?
1 year has passed by the time the Brahma
thing. Oh, yes, Brahma Vimogan Lila. Good example. There also explained. 1 year passes by the time Brahma steals and he just comes back and looks. Just one glance. Well, anyway, I think everyone understood the point.
I think even when
Thank you. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought he goes and Amrish Maharaj is still waiting for him.
Yeah.
Long duration.
I think 1 year
passes.
1 year
passes. Without eating.
Without eating or standing. These things are inconceivable anyway. But we have to understand the principle and move on. For us. We cannot understand it through our material intelligence anyway. That's the point. But
his highness level becomes a best devotee. You look like, you know, because they are researching, like, you know, for example, like, you know, physics and all that. We did classical physics.
Haribol, Prabhu is making a point. Please request everyone to hear.
So these scientists, you know, if they are directed to the Vedas, they will be able to understand the Vedic knowledge really quickly if their consciousness changes, because they are researching all these things, you know, in an indirect way, in the wrong way. But they are also, like, you know, the time, space, time concept. It's already like classical physics, modern physics, you know, it's already giving them all these examples what they have. So, like, you know, once they are directed to the Vedic knowledge, like, we got the example over here, problem. You know, they become the best devotees.
Yeah. So that's why Prabhupada, you know, had disciple Dr. K.D. Singh, who later became Satswarup Das. No, sorry. Swarup Damodar Goswami. Right? So Prabhupada said that I want you to... He saw that he was a very eminent scientist. So he wanted Maharaj to write a lot of books, which explains material science through the eyes of the Vedas. In a language which attracts the scientists, because scientists would always like to have certain level of complication to understand certain things, right? Scientists will not like to read Chanda Mama, for example, or Champak. Once upon a time there was a tiger. You know, obviously, you know, for a scientist there has to be a particular level in which he has to be addressed. So there is this magazine called as Sarva, Siana, what is the magazine? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Satsvarup Dasma, Sarva something. Sarva Loka, something like that. So once someone was distributing, one disciple of Maharaj had come here, he distributed. In my enthusiasm, I bought it. How much I asked? $10. I gave $10. I purchased. I went home and read the first page. And then I went off to sleep after that. I couldn't understand anything. Then I realized this book is not for me. It started with some graph like that. So, gone. Something completely esoteric and some calculations were given there.
It's there in the shop.
Why? I don't think anybody is buying that book. Because nobody will understand. Probably you will understand now. I don't think anybody will understand that book. Okay. That language, it's like a research paper almost. But actually that is a big service, because that is how someone else at that level will get attracted. If you oversimplify for very highly intellectual people, then they don't like it. They may not relish it. So Krishna consciousness has to be presented appropriately to appropriate people with the required level of simplicity or complication. Oversimplifying it will almost make them feel it is mythological in its nature. Right? And overcomplicating it will not enthuse people to enter it. So there has to be always a balance for every segment of society.
Stephen Hawking says, if you enter a black hole and come out of the black hole, other side, there won't be any time there.
There are so many theories. If you enter a black hole, then you will get stretched to the, what is it? To a micron level, whatever. Because of the, people don't understand. But yeah, the point is that the time factor, when we understand the insignificance of material time, then our problems also become insignificant in its nature. We think we and our problems are the center of the existence. Then we at least will come out of that consciousness when we... So these verses, these sections will tell us about our own insignificance in this whole cosmos. So even there was one rishi, I forgot his name, but he was asked by Indira, what benediction you want, no? So he said, and this rishi apparently had a lifespan of some millions of years. But when he was asked to prepare a permanent abode for himself, Lomasa Rishi, is it?
Yes.
So he said that, why do I want this? Because it's such a short flickering time, millions of years lifetime, he's saying. So I don't want to build a permanent abode. But we build permanent abode. Think how to pay mortgage, 25-year loan or 30-year loan. And then we compare this. So we can't relate to all these things. But we have to know. At least it will help us somewhere. Otherwise, we will think our problems are the biggest. Or we will think material solutions will solve eternal problems. Okay, let's read on. Just to keep you awake. Read loudly. That's why I caught you.
Those living beings who reside on higher planets like the sun and the moon, as well as those on this earth planet, and also those who live on lower planets, are all merged into the waters of devastation during the night of Dharma. During this time, no living beings or species remain manifest, although spiritually they continue to exist. This unmanifested stage is called Avyakta. Again, when the entire universe is vanquished at the end of Brahma's lifetime, there is another Avyakta state. But beyond these two unmanifested states is another unmanifested state, the spiritual atmosphere or nature. There are a great number of spiritual planets in this atmosphere, and these planets exist eternally. Even when all the planets within this material universe are vanquished at the end of Brahma's life, there are many material universes, each under the jurisdiction of Brahma, and the cosmic manifestation within the jurisdiction of various Brahmas is but a display of 1/4 of the energy of the Lord. This is the inferior energy. Beyond the jurisdiction of Brahma is the spiritual nature, which is called Tripad Vibhuti, 3/4 of the Lord's energy. This is the superior energy or Para Prakriti.
So what are the points?
Prabhupada says that material energy is eternal, but the manifestation is temporary.
So avyakta means what? That which is unmanifest. So in one sense, the material energy can also be unmanifest and the spiritual energy also can be unmanifest, right? So that is why we call the sometimes we call the spiritual leela as aprakat leela, which doesn't manifest itself. So Prabhupada is comparing these both. So at the when partial annihilation happens, then what happens? All the souls who have not finished their karma in this world, they are sucked into the body of Mahavishnu and they go into a state of sleep, temporary sleep, which is called as Shushupti. After that sleep, then when the next yuga starts manifesting, again the souls are released back. So that is one type of avyakta. So when they are sucked into Lord Mahavishnu, then everything is unmanifest. Again they become manifest. So that is material manifestation. By partial annihilation on the next cycle. So that is what is being referred. And then Prabhupada is saying there is a spiritual world which is never existed. In fact, it is 3/4 of the material creation, but which is not still visible from the 1/4 that we live in. That is also another level of avyakta, which we cannot see with our without purifying our senses. We cannot see the spiritual world. We cannot experience the spiritual world without purifying our senses. Prabhupada is talking about that.
So, sorry, the doubt is, I mean, I have a doubt. So, the avyakta is from the perspective that we are not able to see, that's all. But it's still there. That's the...
Yeah. So, you can read further. Yeah. Who wants to read? Mataji? Ngavidya Mataji. Loudly.
The predominating supreme person residing within the spiritual nature is Lord Sri Krishna. As confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita 8.22, he can be approached only by unalloyed devotional service and not by the processes of jnana, philosophy, yoga, mysticism or karma fruitive work. The karmis of Ruju workers can elevate themselves to the Swargaloka planets, which include the sun and moon. Jnanis and yogis can attain still higher planets such as Maharloka, Tapaloka and Brahmaloka. And when they become still more qualified through devotional service, they can enter into the spiritual nature, either the illuminating cosmic atmosphere of the spiritual sky, Brahman or the Vaikuntha planets, according to their qualifications. It is certain, however, that no one can enter into the spiritual Vaikuntha planets without being trained in devotional service. On the material planets, everyone from Brahma down to the ant is trying to lord it over material nature. And this is the material disease. As long as this material disease continues, the living entity has undergone the process of bodily change. Whether he takes the form of a man, demigod or animal, he ultimately has to endure an unmanifested condition during the two devastations. The devastation during the night of Brahma and the devastation at the end of Brahma's life. If you want to put an end to this process of repeated birth and death, as well as the concomitant factors of old age and disease, we must try to enter the spiritual planets where we can live eternally in association of Lord Krishna or his plenary expansions. His Narayana forms. Lord Krishna or his plenary expansions dominate every one of these innumerable planets, a fact confirmed in the Shruti Mantras, Eko Vashi Sharvaga Krishna Gita, Eko Keshan Babuda Yo Babati. No one can dominate Krishna. It is the conditioned soul who tries to dominate material nature and is instead subjected to the laws of material nature and the sufferings of repeated birth and death. The Lord comes here to re-establish the principles of religion and the basic principle is the development of an attitude of surrender to Him. This is the Lord's last instruction in the Bhagavad Gita, 18.66. Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mam Ekam Sharanam Braja. Give up all other processes and just surrender unto me alone. Unfortunately, foolish men have misinterpreted this prime teaching and misled the masses of people in diverse ways. People have been urged to open hospitals but not to educate themselves to enter into the spiritual kingdom by devotional service. They have been taught to take interest only in temporary relief work which can never bring real happiness to the living entity. They start varieties of public and semi-governmental institutions to tackle the devastating power of nature. but they don't know how to pacify insurmountable nature. Many men are advertised as great scholars of the Bhagavad Gita, but they overlook the Gita's message by which the material nature can be pacified. Powerful nature can be pacified only by the awakening of God consciousness, as clearly pointed out in the Bhagavad Gita 7.15.
Okay. Are looking at their face. I have been asked to explain this once.
Due to getting stuck in this material body, among the material nature, because of our desires, we try to enjoy the material nature, and as we try, we get more and more entangled and suffer more and more until we start realizing that we are not this body and we are just here temporarily. And from that point, the suffering will go.
Okay. So, Prabhupada is pointing here that there is bhakti, mukti, siddhi and prana. So many people are there. Each person is higher than the other in terms of their subtleness of enjoyment. Enjoyment can be gross or subtle. So what is the difference between a pig and a human being? Both are enjoying senses. But the enjoyment of a pig is considered to be more gross than that of a human being. Right? A dog and a human being. A dog will bark at anyone and everyone. But as a human being, we are not expected to bark at everyone. We have to use a little bit of intelligence. So there is a little bit more intelligence and discrimination that is required. But human beings are supposed to be very low compared to the residents of Swarga Loka and even the higher planets, the denizens of the higher planets. Okay. From their point of view, we are like the pigs. Right? Because as we go higher and higher, existence becomes more and more subtler in nature and lesser gross in nature, as we go through the higher planetary system. But Prabhupada says, so when we want more refined sense enjoyment, then we go to heavenly planets. But if we want further happiness, with more subtle happiness, less material happiness, then we go to the higher realms, the Siddha Lokas and all that. And finally up to Brahma Loka. So, but no matter where the soul resides, what is the verse in Bhagavad Gita? Abrahma, Avraloka, Una Ravartino, Arjuna. Right? Maham Upetya? Janmana Vidyati. So even Lord Brahma has to come down into this material world. No matter how subtle the existence is on top, material nature eventually will overcome, and eventually everyone has to, Maya's nature is to push us more from the subtle platform to the gross platform. Those fortunate few who have escaped this by the dint of transcendental knowledge can escape the Brahma Loka and still go into the Brahman. Okay. But even in Brahman, what will happen? After some time, then the Brahman doesn't lead to further inquiry, one will fall down. Even there, eventually boredom catches up, they come down and then fall down. So therefore, only one man goes beyond the Brahman layer, to the Vaikuntha planets, is one assured that one will not
come back
into this material world.
He has to be qualified for that, if he's making it.
Yeah, and then Prabhupada is saying how to qualify oneself. That again, so Prabhupada is therefore introducing, again Krishna is being brought into the paradigm. And Prabhupada is saying that Lord Krishna, and then Prabhupada is giving a description of the spiritual world, where every planet of the spiritual world is being dominated by a plenary expansion of Lord Krishna. So gradually Prabhupada is moving up. So as someone was mentioning this just now, Upti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakali Ashanta Krishna Bhakta Nishkama Ata Eva Shanta. So it's only the devotee who will have real everlasting peace. The peace which is attained by all others are temporary. They may seem very significant if we view it from the point of material time, which he enjoyed for 20 years. What is 20 years? Nothing. Or he enjoyed in Brahman for 100,000 years. But if you see from universal time, it is nothing. You just fall down. That's it. So therefore, an idea of time and planets and happiness, they are all related and then depicted in this paragraph. We read this, no one can dominate Krishna. We read that, right?
Yeah.
So Prabhupada is saying, what is the point here in this paragraph? So he is saying, what is dharma? So in India, Vaidyanacharan Prabhu says that usually when you say dharma, even that beggar in the railway station, dharma karo baba, dharma karo raja, dharma raja, not you. Raja dharma ni.
Dhanraja.
So in India the beggars, I don't know, Maharashtra is Dharma Raja, they become. So usually everybody is Dharma Raja. What a bhikari, huh? Okay. So therefore, so dharma, Chaitanya Vicharan Prabhu says dharma has got a normal connotation, is what dharma means? Charity. Give money. Dharma Pandu. Even after the eclipse, you know, they come. Devdan Chutte Grahan. Chutte Grahan. You know all this or no? Only I have heard all this. After the eclipse, you know, they will come outside the beggars in Bombay. Devdan Chutte Grahan. So, you know, dharma karo. Dharma karne se eclipse nikal jayega. So, dharma usually has got a connotation of only doing,
giving
that kind of material charity. Some material object is being given away. And that too, what people will do also, people will pile up all their unwanted things, you know, unnecessary, which anyway they will throw in the gutter. And then they will give away. So, in the charity kiya. Garib ko dena hai. Like that. So, there is person who is cheating and the person who is also cheated. So, that is going on in the name of dharma. So Prabhupada is writing here, that is not dharma. Highest dharma is what? Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam. Or savai pumsam paro dharma etor bhakti adokshate. So the highest dharma is one by which men can attain unalloyed, unmotivated loving service to the Supreme Lord. And such a dharma is what? Is everlasting. Ahai tuki apratiyata. It is continuously performed, that dharma. It is not dependent on any material situation. So that is real dharma. That is called as para dharma, which Chaitanya Prabhu also said. Or jaiva dharma. What? Apara dharma or para dharma?
Para dharma.
When you, the way you are looking at me, I thought something is...
No.
Para dharma. I also forgot. Maybe it was apara dharma.
No. Para dharma.
Thank you. So this is called, so jaiva dharma or nitya dharma. So that is the eternal nature of the soul. So the nature of the soul, dharma is what? You remember those five definitions or six definitions Chaitanya Charan Prabhu showed on the PowerPoint? One was, it is a characteristic of the living entity. That is called as dharma. That is real dharma. So Lord Krishna says, sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam charanam raja. That means he is asking us to give up all types of apara dharma and to accept the surrender to jaiva dharma. What is the jaiva dharma? Jivera swarupe hoy. So that is what. So Prabhupada is just reminding us that. So all these kinds of philanthropic activities, you know, is not the highest manifestation of dharma. Real dharma is that by which love of God is attained. Any points? So, who are at last?
In this manga, Sri Isopanisad teaches that one must perfectly know Sambhuti, the personality of Godhead and Vinasha, the temporary material manifestation, side by side. By knowing the material manifestation alone, one cannot be saved, for in the course of nature there is devastation at every moment. Nor can one be saved from these devastations by the opening of hospitals. One can be saved only by complete knowledge of the eternal life of bliss and awareness. The whole Vedic scheme is meant to educate men in the art of attaining eternal life. People are often misguided by temporary attraction, attractive things, wisdom sense gratification, but service rendered to the sense objects is both misleading and degrading.
What are the points, sir?
Need to know what is eternal and what is going to be destroyed, and one must need to be able to discriminate between the two.
So Sambhuti and Vinasha. Sambhuti is the eternal supreme personality of God, and Vinasha is a temporary manifestation. So Prabhupada is saying, service rendered to sense objects is both misleading and degrading. This is a very powerful word. It's degrading to serve our senses. Why? Because we are superior energy. So we degrade ourselves and associate ourselves with the inferior energy. When we do abominable activities, we are actually degrading ourselves. We are capable of doing something much higher. And we degrade ourselves into something very low. So the whole Vedic scheme is meant to educate men in this art of attaining eternal life. So in actual practice, therefore, what ISKCON is teaching is the art of living. Art of living and also art of dying. Because that is not being taught anywhere. Art of dying is also important. So, a devotee, this is what, you know, Raja Vidya can give us. Raja Vidya is meant to make us fearless in this world. Just like even in the Srimad Bhagavatam, the pastime of Dhruva Maharaj, towards the end, Prabhupada writes that what he did, he stepped on the head of death and then he sat on the chariot. But at that time, but he had one concern. What was the concern? What about my mother, he said. And Vishnu Dutta said, don't worry about your mother. See, the other chariot is there, no, on platform number 2. So that chariot is also coming, like that. So this is the Vaishnava. Vaishnava means one who is fearless oneself and who can make others also fearless. So Srila Prabhupada's name was Abhaya Charan. Fearless one. So Prabhupada himself was fearless, but by sincerely taking shelter of his books, we are also expected to become fearless. Fear comes from the fear of self-preservation, or that somebody will attack me and destroy me. So we have fear, we have so many fears. This fear can take gross dimensions as this and subtle dimensions also. Subtle dimension, insecurity is what?
Fear.
Insecurity also comes out of fear. So fear that I will not be recognized. Right? All this is, so many things we do simply out of fear, not out of devotion to the Lord. Even our surrender to Krishna is also based out of fear. Our surrender to Krishna is not out of devotion necessarily. So, for example, I remember when Prabhuji's house was under fire, so Mataji ran inside to save the deities. Right? So that should be the mood actually. Fear not doesn't mean that deities ko baad mein dekhte hain, pehle hum log bahar bhagte hain. That is called as fear. But this is called fearlessness. Fearlessness means fearing for the welfare of Krishna. Yashoda mother is always fearful, that is positive fear. Fearing for the Lord. Not worshipping Lord out of fear. Which is also accepted by the Lord. Because bhai, asha, kartavya, buddhi, everything is accepted. But highest is what? Worshipping Lord out of bhakti. Not out of fear, pure fearfulness, but out of devotion. So the whole Vedic scheme is meant to educate people in this arc of eternal life which will lead to fearlessness. So what is the conclusion Prabhupada is saying? We must therefore save ourselves and our fellow men in the right way. There is no question of liking or disliking the truth. It is there. Whether you like it, whether you dislike it. Some student was telling me today, yesterday they are telling me, I don't like this part of mathematics, congruence of triangles, I hate that topic. So what can you do? You have to study it anyway. So you can't choose your syllabus in school, that I don't like this topic, I like this topic. Whether we like or no, we have to study everything. So whether we like or no, we have to accept the problems of this material world and keep moving. So there is no question of liking or disliking the truth. Because the nature of the material world is to give us problems. If we want to be saved from repeated birth and death, we must take to the devotional service of the Lord. There can be no compromise, for this is a matter of necessity. So we have to do it. There is no option that we have. So there is no option or alternative to devotional service. Yesterday also, I was hearing Radhanath Swami Maharaj. He was, this came to me on the network, WhatsApp, some message. So there are small snippets. I don't know who sent that, but somebody is sending. It's very nice. So I clicked on that. And Maharaj was saying that Ram Navami message this was. He's saying that do not worry, do not fear. Even if you are struggling in your devotional life, even if you are going through a very hard time in your material life, do not worry, do not fear. Continuously is hammering the same point. Do not get discouraged, even if you believe that you are not lifting your spiritual life. Do not feel discouraged. It's almost like saying lage raho. That is the message he's saying. Just keep continuing to do this process. The only thing he wants is never seek an alternative to bhakti. That was the only warning he said. Even if you are imperfect in doing bhakti, no problem. Don't worry. Don't get discouraged. But never seek an alternative to bhakti. So Prabhupada is also saying the same thing here. Coincidentally, there is no alternative. There is no compromise. This is the only way. And this is the only way, and this is a good enough way, the sure shot way to take us back to God. He's saying don't deviate from the path, but keep struggling, even if you fail, keep struggling in this path. And that struggle will lead us, take us back to God.